Yellow Cake. And there's another contract I'd like you to handle. It's a wet job, but we need to divert Cypher's attention. Check the mission list for the details.
Boss, sorry to keep you waiting. We finally finished analyzing that Yellow Cake Cypher was moving. There was nothing unusual about the composition of the Yellow Cake itself. Most of it was oxidized uranium, with the rest being impurities, various metals, as well as traces of organic matter. What's interesting is the composition of these impurities. When we checked them against the impurities found in the copper ore, it was clear the Yellow Cake didn't come from Shinkalobwe, meaning they went to the trouble of mining two sources of uranium, then transported them together in different states. Another thing, we detected a very thin layer of highly enriched uranium in the middle of the Yellow Cake. Now that is very interesting. It may not be a lot, but it points to the existence of uranium-enriching technology. After all, Yellow Cake can't naturally produce highly enriched uranium. If they could mass produce this, they'd be just one step away from a gun barrel type nuclear bomb. But uranium enrichment requires advanced technology and a large-scale facility. If that kind of place existed in Zaire, the Soviet Union wouldn't sit idly by. And there's another question. Where were they transporting the Yellow Cake and Malachite uranium? The first place that comes to mind is South Africa. The government was supposed to have abandoned nuclear weapons development after caving to international pressure. But rumors persist that it's continued in secret. Plus, CRS were escorting the truck, and they're based out of South Africa. And then South Africa does have an abandoned test site. If Cypher's involved with nuclear development in South Africa, but how would that fit with their weapon to surpass Metal Gear? We need more information.
Shinkalobwe. There's a name I haven't heard in a while.
The U.S. bought a lot of uranium from Shinkalobwe mine during World War II for the Manhattan Project. They even sent a squad from the Army Corps of Engineers to reopen the mine after it was flooded. That's how good its uranium must have been. With that, the world's first nuclear test was a success. Shinkalobwe uranium might have been used in the Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombs, too. Just hearing its name is like seeing all the phantoms of the war rise up to haunt us. But all the uranium's dried up, and the mine's been closed for years.
So someone reopened it?
Right. Zero Risk Security seized control of the area and were forcing locals to work in it. And the Zairean government was getting a slice of what they took in exchange for looking the other way. Mobutu has to finance his taste somehow. He'll gladly sell the rights to some old mine. The question is, why would Zero Risk Security do this kind of thing?
Or rather, why were their employers, Cypher, interested in an abandoned mine? They'd be getting trace amounts of uranium, yet to the naked eye it appears to be ordinary malachite, meaning security would be lax. Not a very efficient way of obtaining it, but easier to move.
But how would they enrich it at its destination?
Did the Yellow Cake really have a layer of highly enriched uranium in it?
Having trouble believing it?
No. If they say it's real, then it's real. In which case, they might have some enrichment method that we don't know about.
And this was to test it out?
It's possible. And that would mean it's almost complete.
Coyote operates mainly out of Africa these days. Of the three PFs, they're the smallest. However, they scooped up most of the Rhodesian SAS after the country collapsed 4 years ago. Picture their entire organization as one big special forces unit. With Rhodesia a British colony, the Rhodesian SAS had its origins in 22 SAS Sea Squadron. They started out as a group known as the Southern Rhodesia Volunteers, but in 51 they were incorporated into 22 SAS as members of the British Commonwealth and deployed to fight guerrillas in the Malayan Emergency.
Where are your friends? Good. 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 Good.
Coming too. Roger that.
Ja, hulle het uiteindelik helmets begin uitdeel. Goeie goed van Amerika af.
Dit bied beskerming teen die meeste rondte.
Jim, is omtrent hy.
Ja, alhoewel, na een skoot is die goed useless.
Dit is seker te verwagte. Ek hoop net ons kry ons in vinnig.
Ja.
Hold them off!
Subject is in.
Where are your friends?
Roger that.
good dog.
You gotta extract him. Looks like a boar goat. It's raised for its meat, which is tender and delicious. But don't you go eating it.
MPLA het seker heel wat kalmeer sedert daai dae.
Net omdat ons dit so hou. Al die Amerikaanse wapens het 'n moerse verskil gemaak. Niet is besig om beter toegerus te raak.
Ja, die MPLA behoort op die randjie van oorgee te wees. Maar as hulle dit doen, wat word van ons werk?
Wat gaan aan?
Hey!
Subject on board. Leave the rest to us. Roger that.
Where are the others? Speak. Where are your friends?
Subject on board. Leave the rest to us. Off base during the attack 9 years ago. Bring him home, boss.
get him. Hold them off!
Roger that.
Roger that.
Good. Good dog.
Stop!
Kunganga Mine. The civil war's been going on in that region for the last 20 years. It's being fought by what are now two ethnic groups, the Buta and the Mbele. Originally, you could barely tell them apart. But the reason for the current armed conflict goes back to World War I. After the war, their land was colonized by a European power, and it decided to give local control to the Buta. That split the two groups into rulers and subjects, laying the foundations for an inevitable civil war. The friction between them remained even after they won independence from Europe. The Buta are holding on to power to this day, and the Mbele rebels continue to fight back. The conflict is funded by locally mined gold, rare metals, diamonds. They've used the money from those to arm themselves, buy oil, and even hire PFs. The Buta administration owns the mining rights to Kunganga Mine. But most of the laborers are Mbele, who they've taken prisoner. The product they've gouged out of their land is bought up by cheap Western corporations. And the civil war is fueled by the profits. That's how it goes. One country's people is split apart by another country. Then the two groups tear up their own land for money in order to fight each other. Now this civil war started by a foreign power is the norm. And it's sucking up all the country's resources. PFs are just the same. They follow the money, taking war with them wherever they go. That goes for us, too. It's an endless river of bloody retaliation, and we're standing downstream. Should we make a stand and staunch the flow? Or wade in amongst the corpses and make a bigger splash than the rest? We'll follow your lead, boss. Thank you.
Roger.
fire.
Huh?
Subject on board. Leave the rest to us.
Speak.
Where are your friends?
Extract him.
Talk.
Where are the others?
Subject on board. Leave the rest to us.
Mm-hmm.
coming too. Roger that.
Where are your friends? Mm-hmm.